Hey, how you doing? Thanks for tuning in. I'm glad you're here. I'm Jimmy. In this video, I drew up some charts. I want to talk to you about electricity in an automobile. A couple people want to ask me to do a video about it. Stay tuned. All right, guys, one of the things I want to talk to you about in this video, a lot of people have been asking me, can you do some electrical classes? So one of the things I figured we would talk about first is parallel versus series. A lot of people seem confused about that. I get a lot of questions. So that's what we're going to talk about today. And I've made some diagrams to help explain some of these things, because especially for me, I'm a visual person. I got to get my hands in there, get my brain figuring out what's going on by seeing it. You can explain it to me till you're blue in the face, I probably won't get it. I'm thinking a lot of you probably sympathize with that. Parallel versus series electrical. In series, higher resistance. Parallel, two 12 volt batteries here. When they talk about parallel versus series, parallel means the two items are working together, or three or four, however many items are working together. In a series, they're working as one unit. So when you run wiring in parallel, if you say you add two batteries in a vehicle, you don't want to step the voltage up because you'll damage the vehicle, right? So if you do it this way, negative to negative and positive to positive, what happens is you end up with the same voltage, but you double the amperage. So if you had two 12 volt batteries of 500 amps apiece, you'd have 1,000 amps, but it would still be 12 volts done this way, because all you're doing is having both batteries powering the circuit the same way. Now, this might look like it would cause a short in the battery, but it's positive, negative to positive, negative to negative. What happens here in a series, you're running, everything is chained together, basically daisy chained. So what happens now is, since it's passing through the other battery to get to the final product, whatever you're running on, electric motor, just testing it with a voltmeter, you would see 24 volts going positive to negative here. It's still only 12 volts and 12 volts, but the voltage doubles in this case. But the problem is you lose your amperage. So you still only have 500 amps because the batteries are working together rather than independently as they are when they're parallel. I hope I'm explaining that correctly for you so it makes sense. Whenever you want to step up the voltage, you know, electric motors are way more efficient. The higher the voltage is, the more efficient the motor runs. So if you step up the voltage, you don't need as much amperage. In a case like this where the voltage is half, you probably need a little more amperage to get the same power from the motor efficiency. This is actually going to be a more efficient setup, but you're not going to have all the available amperage that you'd want or current. Same thing in a light bulb. If you run light bulbs so that both are grounded to a single ground and both are powered by a single power, both light bulbs will light the same brightness, and both of them will use full amperage. If each one pulls half an amp, they would both pull an amp, right? So you would be multiplying the draw from a battery. But if you run them in series, it would go positive, negative to the positive filament in the bulb, from negative to negative, similar to the way you did with a battery. Well, now what's going to happen is they're each only going to take half the available amperage. So the bulbs will all light, but they'll be a little more dim because they're splitting load, if that makes sense. It's something that when you have a bunch of light bulbs together, very often they're wired like this. If you don't need it bright, you just want light to cover a wider area, you could do them all like this and have even light with less shadows and a larger area. If you do them like this, usually it'll draw more current. It'll be a little less efficient, but it'll be brighter. You're going to get hotter light. So that's basically wattage. Amps times volts equals watts, right? And the way you're going to determine, like if you had a certain gauge wire, you can only go to, say, 14 gauge wire. You might want to use this circuit, this system, because it doesn't need as thick of a wire. It's not going to flow as much amperage as this one would. You'd have to use heavier gauge wire. That's just a rough example to give you an idea of why you might want to do one versus the other. Most of the time, parallel versus series, it's going to be with a battery or a power source, or it could be like a resistor. And I drew up on the next page, resistors. A lot of people ask me why, when there's 220 ohm resistors in a car's circuit, the CAN circuit, right? Communications Area Network is what CAN stands for. People say, why is it 60 ohms when there's 220 ohms resistors? This is a parallel circuit. So you're going to run positive to negative, and you're going to have a resistor across positive and negative, a resistor across positive and negative. And you're going to have, say, a PCM or something over here, or a BCM, whatever might have these resistors. But what some people don't wrap their head around, which I had a hard time understanding as well, you kind of have to pound it into my thick skull, but the reason that this has half the amperage is because there's multiple resistors giving more paths for the electricity to pass through, or the voltage to pass through. So since it has more paths, it lowers the resistance. But if you run them in a series, similar to the way that battery example is, this is the same, even though it looks a little more confusing than that one. This is basically what you're doing. Positive, negative, positive, negative. Now, you're going to be multiplying the resistors. If you had a 60 and an 80, you'd have 120 ohms. If you have 120, 120, you're going to have 240 ohms, etc. So there's only one path. The electricity has no choice but to go through all of them. In this one, the electricity can go several different ways, so they actually cancel each other out a little bit and cut the resistance in half. If you have, like, if you have a 20 ohm in here, 120 and 120, you're going to have less than the 20 ohms of resistance on that circuit. It's always less than the lowest resistor. As long as they're parallel, the total resistance will always be lower than the lowest resistor in the circuit. So it's not something that you're going to need to know too often for repairing automobiles, except for the fact that if you put your ohm meter in 4 and 16 in a can connector, which is right here. Is it 4 and 16? I forget right now. It's escaping me. If you check for resistance in a can connector across the two pins on the can circuit, then all you're going to care about is, why am I seeing 120 ohms? And you'll know if you have two modules that have the resistor, the PCM and the BCM might have them on some cars. You know if you unplug the BCM and you still have 120 ohms, that was the problem. If you unplug it and have no resistance, then your BCM's offline and it has an open. So that's the real reason for having to know the way these resistors are wired and why it works the way it works. Just think of it as if there's multiple paths for the electricity to get to the other side. This one, it's forced down the one wire, so it's going to double. This one cuts it in half. So a lot of times, like a motorhome, the house side might have batteries wired this way, and the engine cranking batteries would have it wired this way, because to crank a big engine in a diesel or a V10 motorhome, you're going to want a lot of cranking amperage. But starters aren't designed for more than 12 or 15 volts, so you don't want to have it wired like this. But yet the refrigerator and the inverter and things on board the motorhome can handle more voltage, and they run more efficiently that way, but you get less amperage. That's why the batteries might be wired like that in a motorhome on the house or residential side of the motorhome. So a lot of things. Electricity is one of those things that it seems like voodoo, because you don't have a mechanical thing. Being a mechanic, I want to grab an alternator and see what's in it, and I can figure that out pretty well. But when you talk about electricity, it's invisible. Unless you have a meter or a way to test it, a heat gun or something, you can't see what's going on in electrical circuits. People way smarter than me make circuit boards with so many complicated circuits on the circuit boards, and they're calculating capacitance, resistance, all these kinds of things, and they're doing all kinds of complicated electrical things that we don't have to really deal with in this business. All we have to do is figure out powers, grounds, how much resistance should it have, how much resistance does it have versus what it should have, what went wrong inside the module. We don't have to worry about designing and fabricating these things. We just have to know we have to know a little bit about them to help us with our diagnosis. So things like a light bulb in a car, one of the things that I could tell you that might help you out if you're starting out mechanic or a DIYer, one of the quickest and easiest ways to test for a bad ground is with a test light. You put it to ground, you get the test light back probed into the ground side of the light socket, and if the light gets bright, you have a bad ground, because the test light will act like another ground on the ground side. You put it on the power side, the test light will light. and you put it on the ground side, the test light won't light, but the bulb will come on. You know you have a bad ground. If your bulb's lit dimly and you poke the ground with a test light, back probe through the wire. Don't pierce the wire if you can avoid it. That's another video, but you can pierce the wire if you're going to be willing to fix it afterwards, either with nail polish or a little RTV or some liquid tape, that kind of thing. But I pierce wires in a pinch if I have to. I don't hesitate to, but I always fix them afterwards, because you do the customer a terrible disservice when 2, 3, 4 years down the road. If you live up north where Eric O is, 6 months down the road, he'll be making a video about the corroded wiring. So you got to be careful with that. But it's one of the best things I found. A test light is such a good universal tool, because it'll never produce a short in a circuit. If you poke something with a test light, the test light's going to light if the circuit can carry enough current to light it. But if you're on a power side and you put a test light on it, it's going to light. It's not going to hurt anything. If you're on the ground side, it's going to help you ground it. It's not going to hurt anything. One of the things I really like with an incandescent test light, the LED ones are good for computer circuits. If you're on a 5-volt circuit and you don't want to try to force a computer to run half an amp to light up your test light, you can use an LED test light. But I don't like the LED test lights because they don't work as well for testing grounds and other things like that. So I'm trying to think if there's anything else I could talk to you about in this video. I just wanted to make the first, I'm going to do a few electrical videos, and I didn't go to college for electrical. I'm nowhere near as smart as someone like Scanner Danner, Paul. These guys are much smarter than me when it comes to that kind of stuff, because they're trained in that kind of stuff and spend a lot of time. Matter of fact, they're instructing that stuff. Even though I'm a master mechanic and I've been doing this over 40 years, I've been flat rate my whole career. So in flat rate, you're just not spending the time to submerge yourself in the hows and whys. I go a little bit above and beyond your average flat rate mechanic, just because my brain, in order for it to function and figure things out, I have to have some idea of the theory of operation, the process it uses to get to the end result. So I know enough about electrical to do my job. That's basically the bottom line. There's a lot of guys that'll tell you all about switching diodes and piezo transistor stuff. That's not my specialty. My specialty is powers, grounds, resistance. I can build a circuit. I can say it's 12 volts. It pulls 5 amps. It needs, 12 or 14 gauge wire, because that's one of the main things about knowing your electrical world, is if you have to rewire a circuit, like make a trailer wiring harness because you can't buy one, then you need to say, how much amperage can this trailer pull? How many lights are in the trailer? What's the total amperage? It's going to be working on 12 volts. So if you find out that thing's got so many bulbs on it, they have lights all around an enclosed trailer, let's say, and that thing pulls 20 amps, then you have to know amps times volts equals watts and calculate your wire gauge that you're going to need to use. You might need to use 10 or 10 gauge wire on something that pulls a lot of current. So that's why you have to be able to figure some of those things out. But normally, you don't even need to know the amps times volts equals watts theory, because you're going to be using test lights, voltmeters, and tools like the PB600 from Ancel. I'm doing a video on that. I think that video will be out before this one. Tools like that are invaluable in testing those circuits, finding out why something's not working. You're going to be lacking your power or ground, or you have a problem with that. It's called an appliance. Like a light bulb is an appliance, a blower motor, a fan motor is an appliance. It's something that is handy to have to be able to sort those things out. And the more you know about this kind of stuff, the better off you are. The guys that are on salary tend to be a little bit better at this kind of thing, because they can submerge themselves in it and spend hours doing research for something that might only cost a customer $100. Where for me, if we're charging a customer $100, they expect it to be done in 30 or 40 minutes. So it's a different world. One of the things I don't like when I see a lot of YouTube channels criticizing mechanics is that the mechanics are basically playing the cards they're dealt. And some shops set their mechanics up for failure. So knowing a little bit about this stuff is going to help you not be that guy that they're making videos about who couldn't diagnose an oxygen sensor, or like the purge valve I had not too long ago. The computer was grounding the purge valve all the time. The only way it would not is if you shut the key off. As soon as you turn the key on, it ground the purge valve. So someone put a purge valve in and it didn't fix it. and it wasn't a complicated repair. It's not that I'm so smart. It's just that I said, well, they already put a purge valve in it. Let's check powers and grounds, and it had a ground all the time. I traced it back to the PCM. I unplugged the connector from the PCM. The ground went away. So I knew that the PCM was a problem. So things like that are why you need to know how these circuits work, how the difference between parallel, series, how to use a test light. And we'll do some more videos on these topics. And I'm probably going to do 4 or 5 different electrical videos. I'm going to try to get some more of this kind of content out for you guys. A lot of people have been asking for it. Working 7 days a week, sometimes I just can't do it. Doing the best I can. Rowing my boat. So, hope this video helps you guys out. If you're new and struggling a little bit with electrical, nothing to be afraid of. Use a test light and a voltmeter and go around figuring things out. Seeing how they work when they're working well, so that when they're not, you'll know what you're looking at is not correct. So, thanks for watching, guys. Hope you enjoyed it. I certainly enjoyed your company. Maybe I'll see you in another video, I hope, because you're awesome.